of Jesus. How many people are champion in this house? Let me see your hand. Are you a champion? Are you a champion? Even if you are not a champion before you arrive here, you are a champion from this moment. In the mighty name of Jesus. Whatever that troubles your life, you will begin to trouble that from this moment. I told you last Sunday, any area that is troubling your life is where God wants to make you a champion. Hello? It's where God wants to make you a champion. I prophesy and I speak into your life. Whatever that is your complaint this morning, they shall turn to your testimony today. In the name of Jesus. We are champion. And champion never quit. Why? Because we live in a continuous victory. And we have been equipping ourselves on how to live a continuous living. How many of you can remind me what we taught last week, Sunday? Can somebody remind me? What was the topic for last week, Sunday? Okay, look at your book. I won't go until you tell me. Living a victorious life via what? Leadership mentality. Hello? Church is a clinic. Church is a school of life. You have no reason any moment to be a failure as long as you are a Christian. As long as you are a believer, as long as you are a Wami family, you are now a Wami student. Forget about, I didn't go to school. I didn't have my tree. I didn't go to university. Welcome. Okay, now that you are in Wami Institute of Life, you must end your certificate. Are you getting what I'm saying? So we are teaching in this auditorium, in this altar, the life orientation. Whatever you have lost in the classroom, you will regain more than it in this place. It's a school of life. So I want to give you another, and I want to deliver into your hand another certificate of living. Another what? Certificate of living. Last Sunday, I gave you a certificate of leadership. How to live a victorious life with your leadership mentality. Winner don't quit. Tough time never cease. But tough people live. Hear me, if anybody deceive you, that don't worry, hey, life is easy. It's a lie. Life is tough. And only the tough people survive in the tough life. The reason why you are not successful, or why men or some men are not successful, is because they are not tough to defeat the toughest life. You don't have a tough skin. If you don't have tough skin, you cannot live and survive in this tough life. People of God. Forget about your classroom teaching. Forget about your doctorate degree. When a doctor or a, what do we call it? A professor. How many of you have seen professor, doctors, and wanga they were that have no bicycle? Hello? They have no what? Bicycle. So, success is not only, about your classroom education, about your degree or your certificate. Success is about your wisdom, your intellect, and how much of God you know. So I'm giving you a new certificate after last week's certificate of leadership. Listen to me. You are born as a leader. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, don't look down on yourself. You are born as a leader? And how can you sustain the leadership ability? I gave you all so many things last week. I hope some of you can begin to remind me. Any of you can remind me? Some of the things that some of the secrets, looking at Jephthah's life. Jephthah was a man under a precarious situation. Jephthah was a man that lived under a precarious situation. And he was a man that was what? That was kept, that was lived, or that lived in where? Can somebody remind me? He was a man, he lived all his life in where? Tob. In a tob. Or in the tob. Whatever you call it. Tob, tob. He lived in the life, hear me? You can call the life of Jephthah like a man living in Mukuku, shack. He was a mighty man. He was born to be mighty. But his family, his brethren, they chased him out. And he began to live where? In the sack. But say not the next. Say never the next. Say never the next. So you must always remember this one. Say never the next. Say it again. Even if you don't have matric or CV, say never the next. I was born as a champion. Hear me. It doesn't matter what the life is giving you now. What matters is what you are giving to the life. Can I tell you the truth? When God created life, he created everything beautiful. But Satan corrupted the head. So it is only the people that can walk in line with God that can defeat every satanic agenda. And you are one of them. You are one of them. So I want to give you another secret of how to live a victorious life. In addition to what I taught you last week. And I remember also, can somebody remind me this? You must always what? Refuse to be what? A refuse. Even when you are a refugee, can you claim it? Say it to yourself. Say it to your neighbor. I want to know if you understand it. Say, neighbor, even if you are a refugee in your father's house, even if you are a refugee in this country, you must refuse to be a refuse, because God is your refuge. Hey, come on, give the Lord a clap offering. I want somebody to repeat it very well. Say it to yourself. Even if I'm a refugee, I refuse to be a refuse, because God is my refuge. That's why we are here. That's the only reason why we are here. Lord, you are my refuge. I refuse to be a refuge. A refuse. So that's it to you. Don't let anybody call you query. You are not. You are born as a leader. And you are born to live a victorious life. You are born to live your life as leader. With the wisdom of God. With the wisdom of God. So this morning I want to continue on the secret of living a victorious life. On the secret of leadership. Via the parable of our brother Jephthah. Your brother Jephthah. What is the secret? Hear me before I go on. I bring this word as living a victorious life, the giving productivity. The what? The giving productivity. That is, I want to teach you on the mysteries of giving. Leadership is by giving. One of the qualities of someone that wants to be a leader is your ability to have the giving spirit. You want to be a good leader? You want to live a leadership life? You must cultivate this spirit of giving. Because you know why? Every leader, they are servant to the followers. They are servant to their followers. If you are not ready to give your life as a leader to the people you want to lead, you can never succeed as a leader. The worst you can be is to be a tyranny or to be the worst leader. You can never be a good parent if you are not ready also to submit or to live yourself, to lead your family. So this morning I want to drop another certificate of living a victorious life. Whatever that is not productive, they can be destructive. Whatever that is not productive in your life, they can be what? They can be destructive. Now, let's go back to our Bible reading. Let's go into the life of our brother, and then we'll see what is another secret of living. Judges chapter 11, verse 30. One of the secrets that made Jephthah a leader, one of the victories that make the latter hand of Jephthah victorious, is the secret I want you to learn today, which is the secret of giving. The spirit of giving. So I want us to quickly look at what is the secret or the mystery. You have been hearing it, but you will hear it in another dimension today. You've been hearing it, but it's not making meaning, it's not making sense to you because you don't understand it. But today, faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing the word of God. So you will hear it in another fashion today. Maybe this one will make meaning to you, and it will make meaning to your life. And you will find yourself in this school of wisdom. Let's read verse 30. And Jephthah made a vow to the Lord. He made what? A vow to the Lord. He said, if you give the Ammonites into my hands, whatever comes out of the doors of my house to meet me when I return in triumph from the Ammonites will be the Lord's, and I will sacrifice it at a burnt offering. Verse 32. Then Jephthah went over to fight the Ammonites, and the Lord gave into his hands, and he devastated 20 towns. From Aroa to the vicinity of Mennonite, as far as Abel Kerami, thus Israel subdued Hamor. The Lord gave him a stone that the builder rejected, that has become the cornerstone. Hear me, I don't know what the enemy has done in your life. I don't know what has been your stories from the beginning of the year, but I know what God is about to do for you in this latter end of this year. I saw what God did in the life of Jephthah, so I know what he's about to do in your life. The Bible says, at Jephthah made a vow. Now let's go on before we analyze it. Now, verse 34. When Jephthah returned to his home in Mizpah, who should come out to meet him but his daughter, dancing to the sound of timbrels. She was an only child. Except for her, he had neither son nor daughter. When he saw her, he tore his clothes and cried, "Oh no, my daughter, you have brought me down, and I am devastated. I have made a vow to the Lord that I cannot break." Verse 36. "My father," she replied, "you have given your word to the Lord. Do to me just as you promised. Now that the Lord has avenged you of your enemies, the Ammonite. But grant me this one request." She said, "Give me 2 months to roam the hill and weep with my friends, because I will never marry." Verse 38. She said, "You may go." He said, and he let her go for 2 months. She and her friends went into the east and wept because she would never marry. Verse 39. After the 2 months, she returned to her father. Underline, she returned to her father. And he did to her as he had vowed. And she was a virgin. Hallelujah. Jephthah made a vow to the Lord. "Lord, if you give me breakthrough, Lord, if you give me breakthrough, I will give you whosoever that first come out of my house in my return to you." And God recorded it. God what? God recorded it. And Jephthah went to the war. And because of the vow that he made, the Lord honored his vow and gave him victory over the enemy. Hear this. Hear this. It was Jephthah's vow. It was Jephthah's victory. Jephthah giving. Jephthah have not seen the victory yet, but he gave a vow. And God have not seen the vow yet and gave him the victory. And Jephthah fulfilled his victory, even though it was a painful vow. It was what? A painful giving. So I want you to learn something from this parable. The parable of giving. The parable of what? Giving. It was the giving life of Jephthah that made him triumphant and made him victorious for the rest of his life. What can we learn? What is the mysteries of this giving? I want you to emulate, I want you to learn from the victory of this man. Because the secret of a man, or the success of a man, is in the secret. He made a vow. "Lord, if you bless me, I will in return be a blessing to you." The scripture cannot be broken. The Bible says, "I will bless you, and you shall be a blessing to others." In order for you to be blessed, in order for you to live a victorious life, you must be a leader that knows how to give. Leadership begins from the giving of your heart. Leadership begins from what? the giving of your heart. When you see every leader that are terrible, that they are tyranny, they have no giving in their life. I want you to learn something from today. Giving. The mysteries of giving. And you can only be a giver when you know how to give and what to give. That's why every last Sunday of the month, we come to this altar to give in thanks. It's part of our giving to the Lord. So today, how many of you want to know about giving? Let me see your hand. How many of you want to know about giving? Hello? How many of you want to know about giving? How many of you want to live a giving life? Are you sure? Okay, how many of you are ready to give me your life? How many of you are ready to give me your life? Let me see your hand. You are ready to give me your life. Let me see your hand. You are ready to give me your life. Let me see your hand. 1, 2, 3. Even Mama Tau is not ready to give me his life. By the way, are you happy to see Mama Tau in the house? Let's give her the clap offering. How many of you know that God answered prayer? I was praying last Sunday. Oh Lord, one thing I ask of you, let my wife return to me. Don't you see my wife now? God will give the Lord a clap of favor. So, in humility, honestly speaking, if you are not ready to give your life to others, you can't promise to love. You are not in love with that person. Your love is partial. I can see all the people now that they didn't love me. You love me, but your life is partial. Because I ask, how many of you are ready to give me your life? Only 2 or 3 people are ready. In fact, for all of you, I'm ready to give my life to you also. So, in fact, I lay my life already down long, long time for every one of us and every one of you. If you have not taken it, take it today. Hello? Take it. As you see me, I don't have life. I'm already a dead person in the spiritual realm. Why? My life is to see your life. That's what God sent me to. And that's the life I live. And you shall know them by their truth, by their fruit. You can't lie about giving. It will prove you out. So I want to teach you how to live a living life. How to live a giving life. Because giving is living. And living is what is giving. Listen, can I tell you one secret? Hear me today. If you have not received half or one of your covenant expectation for 2018, there is a problem with your expectation. There is a problem in your life which God wants you to sort out. And I want you to sort it out today. Everybody that give, Lord give me car this year, Lord give me husband, Lord give me. The reason why you have not received one or two is because your request was defect, was disabled. You have asked only for selfish thing, for yourself. You have not had anything for God. So God wants to give us another opportunity before the 12th month to amend. So tomorrow, when we are coming for the watch hour, you will come again with the last thing you are still expecting for God to do for you in this last quarter. And now you will do it with meaning. You will put your expectation up. You will now put your vow down. God wants to see that your heart is towards what you want to receive. Because if your heart is not towards what you want to receive, God is not ready to give it to you. Because if God gives it to you, God knows that he's going to lose you. And God don't want to lose you. So God asked me to teach you today what is the mysteries of giving. Because giving is living. Excuse me, you are dying, my people. You are what? You are dying because your hand is tight. So, what is giving? If you want to live a life of giving, you want to live a victorious life, you want to live a championship life, I want to give you this certificate of giving. It will change your perspective of what to give, how to give, who to give. Number one, type of giving. Type of giving. There are three main giving that I can identify in this service today. Number one, giving to God. Say giving to God. Tap your neighbor. Say neighbor. Number one, giving is giving to God. Number two, giving is giving to men. Is what? Is what? Giving to men. Now, every type of giving or all type of giving or what kind of giving are centered on men and God. Hello? Where, unfortunately, I have seen some people that have also added giving to the animals. Because I read one man in Nigeria or wherever he's coming from that give half of his life or whatever on the internet to his cat. His what? His cat. There are so many demonic things are happening in this world now. He give his property. He will in his will. He will his property to cat. Don't you think that that man need to come and sit down here now? And because that means he has lost the senses of giving. What to give, who to give. So such person need to come and sit down here and rebrand his thinking. So I want you to rebrand your thinking. Because giving is living. Everyone that are living a stingy life, that are living a dry life, is because they are not giver. They may probably not be a giver. That's why life is tight. The only things we know about church, or the word the church this day, are preaching about giving. You know that church everywhere globally only know how to preach about tithing and offering. That's all. But today I'm not going to teach, I'm not going to talk about tithing or offering. Because everyone, every churches in the world now, they have commercialized ministry to the ministry of offering tithe. And so they have confused people. They have deluded the mind of people. They have corrupted the mind of people. They have denied people of what God wants to do for them. By teaching the world types of giving. Please, I'm not going to teach about your tithe or your offering. So if I'm not teaching about tithe and offering, that means there is something more than tithe and offering that can make your life a life of giving. And so stop condemning yourself that you are not a tither. It's good to tithe. It's good to give offering. And I will show you some type of giving. To God, to men. Now, giving to men, let me start from there before giving to God. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 17. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 17. What does he say? He said, I will read my version here. He said, whosoever is generous to the poor, lend to the Lord, and he will repay him for his deed. He that hath pity upon the poor, lendeth unto the Lord, And that which he had given, he will pay him again. He that is generous to the poor, lend to the Lord. That is, give to the Lord. So, giving to men is giving to God. Giving to men is giving to God. So your giving to men is as a result of what comes of your mind to the Lord. Giving to men is your giving to God. Now, not there is nobody that you can on this earth, hear me, you can give to anybody. Pastor, who can I give? What kind of men? I will soon show you different type of men. So you can give to anybody. Now, let me talk before we even go to the men on giving to God. Giving to God. I will say to you categorically this morning that your first primary assignment in the law, in the school of giving, is your giving to God. Because God is the number one thing in our life. See this. It is your, and what is your giving to the Lord? Number one, what are you giving to the Lord? The first thing to give to the Lord is your love to him. Your love to him. Your love. Your first giving on this earth is your love to him. Your second giving on this earth is giving your life to him. Giving what? Your life to him. You cannot give God your life if you don't love him. For God so loved the world that he gave. He first loved us, then he gave. For any one of you to give his or her life for me, you must first love me. If you cannot love me, you cannot give your life to me. But if you love me, your love will compel you to do anything for me. That's why I will not blame people when they give carelessly. It is their love that prepared their giving. But in the school of giving, your first law of giving is giving your love. And then your secondary giving on this earth is giving your life to him. What is giving your life to him? By receiving the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. It's a giving. Hello? It's what? It's a giving. Lord, thank you for dying for me. And then you say, I love you. You have fulfilled number one fundamental law of giving. Giving your love, giving your life. Talking about the giving into the Lord, number three gift or the giving of the Lord is your free will giving. Free will giving. Your free will giving. What is our free will giving unto the Lord? Giving your substances, giving your tangible, either be mean a physical giving, something that we can feel, anything unto the Lord, makes you a giver to the Lord. Hello, listen to me. How many of you buy a farm? Or how many of you buy KFC and say, oh God, I love you. This is your KFC. Angel of the Lord, oh yeah, take it. How many of you does that? How many of you will buy a farm and say, oh God, you know it's very hot now. I love you. This is the fan I bought for you. Take it. But you can buy fan. You can buy aircon for God when you buy it into his house. Is it making sense? God, I love your people. I love your house. I can see people sweating. I'm buying this fan. I'm buying this aircon into your house. You have given unto the Lord. God did not even ask you by that time, give me your money. But you can give in substances. Hello. Giving your life unto the Lord also is giving your time to the Lord. You can give your time. Your what? Your time to God. For example, now you are in church this morning. It is your love that made you to give him these 2 hours or 3 hours to spend here to him. It is your love. You could as well decide in your heart that I'm going to do my washing. Why? Because you love your clothing. You can decide that I'm going to clean my house because you love your house to be clean. But you decided to give him 2 hours, 3 hours in this service today. It's because you love him. And that takes me to another love of God, which is the assembly of his people. It is your love that make you to gather here in his assembly. Because you can claim to love God and on your TV. Let me watch T.D. James today. Let me watch Emmanuel TV today. Let me watch Zion TV today. You still love God, all right? But you showing his love to the congregation, to the meeting of his people, is an advancement of your love. Lord, I love you, but I want to be in my house and watch TV and watch all the preaching. God said, but that's not enough. Go into the assembly of my brethren. You know what? It is your love that made you to be a Wami family. Because without you, there is no Wami family. You love him, that's why you identify yourself with him. And that's why you are here every Wednesday, every Sunday, to prove that you love him. If you love him, you won't sleep in your house on Sunday. You won't sleep, you won't go to your business every time there is a service. But your love made you to move yourself from your house, from your office, to the assembly of God. Some people love their business so much than God. So no matter how, you can't see them on Wednesday service. Because they love their business more than God. Some people, they love their business, they love their relative more than God on Sunday. That is when they are going to visit their relative. Who do you love on Sunday will determine where you will be on Sunday. Your love for God is your giving unto him. Hallelujah. What is another giving to God? How can I give God? What can I give God to show my love for him? Your praises unto the Lord. Your what? Your praises. your worship unto the Lord. Your praise and worship, they are symbols of your love unto the Lord. Please let not your praise and worship be only on Sunday service. I want you to live a life of praise and worship unto the Lord. In your house, learn how to sing to the Lord. Learn how to dance to the Lord. When you wake up, first thing is, Father, thank you. Even if you don't know how to do anything. When you are stressing your body, even when you yawn, just say, oh, Father, thank you. It's your love for him. Hello? You know, some of us, we like to yawn. You know what? Anytime next time you want to yawn, if you don't know how to do that, you just say, thank you. And people will know that you are making, you are communicating. Hello? So anytime you even want to yawn in church, now where you want, just say, thank you, Jesus. You will see the next person around you will say, amen. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. So, it is your spirit of love that can make you to praise him. Thanksgiving. In praises, in worship. Please, I want you to live a life of thanksgiving. Father, thank you. Lift up your hand and say, Father, thank you. Tap your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Say, neighbor, say thank you, Jesus, for the gift of life. Please learn how to give praises, not only in church, in your house, in your car. Please, if this is getting difficult for you, if you have CD player in your house, buy any praise and worship CD. Play it in your office. Play it in your car. Your spirit will follow the praises. And then you'll be able to be saying and singing along with them will energize your spirit into the spirit of giving. Once you are doing that, you are giving to the Lord what God cannot give to himself. Hello? Giving to the Lord in your thanksgiving. Giving also to men in your appreciation. It's another spirit of giving. Giving what? Unto men. A spirit or the giving of appreciation. Hello. So many people under the sound of my voice or that are hearing me now, we are people with ungrateful heart. We are never grateful. Why? Because it's always difficult for you to say thank you. Why is it difficult for you to say thank you? You are looking for a car, you are looking for property in this year 2018, but God has given you a room. Why don't you say, Father, thank you to him? A man or your friend give you something, even though it's not enough to what you are looking for. Why don't you say to him or say to her, thank you? Sons and daughters, how many times did you say thank you to our parents? Wife and husband, how many times do you say thank you to your partner? Sons and daughters in the Lord, how many times also do you say thank you to your prophet, to your pastor? Hello. When, listen to me, what makes you living a triumphant life, a championship life? When you go back to somebody to say thank you, the person keeps giving it to you. Your lamp keep recording in his head, and he keep giving to you, and you keep living a victorious life. Other than somebody that never remember to go back and say thank you. Please look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, thank you for sitting by my side. Hey, listen, there are so many empty seats here. They can stand up now and they don't want to sit by you. Hello? So you are very important. That's why they are even sitting by you. Come and shake the person. Shake somebody. Shake somebody. Either in front or in back or back. Say thank you for sitting by my side. Live a life of appreciation. Because what you don't appreciate, it will depreciate. What is another type of giving? Your vow to the Lord. We're talking about to the Lord now. Give it to the Lord. Your vow unto the Lord. Lord, I don't have, but I know that you will give me. I'm making a vow. That is debtor vow. That is Anna vow. Anna never received, but she gave in advance. Jephthah never received, but he gave in advance. Maybe after service today, you can decide now, Lord, I've been writing, give me this, give me husband, give me wife, give me car, give me job. I've never written my vow. Lord, I repent today. This is my vow. Watch what my God will do for you this month. Watch it. Your vow unto the Lord. Even if it's not here now, even if it's not in your hand, let God see your heart. And your heart can be seen or can be fed by your vow. Hallelujah. How can I give to God? Giving to the less privileged is your giving to the Lord. I'm not yet talking about giving to men, but giving to the Lord. When you are giving to the less privileged, you are already giving to the poor. Who are the less privileged? The poor among us. Who are the poor among us? Somebody that has no food. You don't necessarily have to give him money. Give him food. Anytime I'm driving and I'm eating KFC or I'm eating McDonald's or I bought McDonald's or I have banana, I'm taking to the office, and when I stop by those people that wipe your glasses, I don't give them money. I take from my banana. If it is four, I will take two. Take. If I'm drinking milkshake like you, and I meet them, I will leave the rest and give them. You are giving food to the poor, to the less privileged. How many times, listen to me, in your life, have you ever given somebody that has no school fees? Have you ever give somebody a school fees? Have you ever given somebody money for operation in the hospital? You have been giving, you have been going to greet people in hospital. You have been going to greet people that deliver by cesarean. All you have done is to say, congratulations, we have come to celebrate you. When are you coming home? They say, no, we are still having some bee. You say, God will provide. Why don't you also provide? Also, give it the less privilege. How many medical bills have you paid for somebody? People of the Lord, how many persons have you given shelter in your house? oh, somebody has just come to you, I don't have accommodation. Why don't you tell the person, well, I have no extra room, but can you manage in my sofa? But instead, what do you say? I have no accommodation. We know you don't have accommodation, but you have sofa in your house that the person can sleep. Why don't you offer him or offer her? You are a stingy person. Why? Give. Somebody has come to you. I don't have electricity in my house. I don't have the money to pay. Why don't you give that person 50 rand or 100 rand to buy electricity? This is giving. Hello? Am I making sense to you? Please, look for somebody every day, every time, to be a blessing to you. Look for the poor to be a blessing to them. Now, giving to men, how can I give? There are different types of men. There are different types of men. One of the men we are talking about is giving to the men of God. And I'm going to quickly explain this one to you, because this is area where many of us are missing it, where many of us are being duped, wasting our giving, or substituting our giving and making us not receiving anything from God, because you are trying to receive from men. Type of giving, giving to men is part of them. But now I will show you different type of giving to men and how people can give to men and not receiving. People now in this world prefer to give to men than to give to God. Whereas your primary giving is to give to God before men. But this day, people prefer to give to men before God. Now, I'll show you something. In this so-called Christian world, we have been taught about prophetic giving. Yes, prophetic giving. What is prophetic giving? People of the Lord, giving to the prophet. Who are the prophets? Who are the prophets? Giving to prophet is one of the giving to men, but not all to the giving of God. Can I tell you something, people of God? I want to warn you from today. Wami family, I want to warn you from today. And I've been saying it. You are a fool if after, as a Wami family, anybody brainwash you from what we are teaching you on this mountain. You will be a fool if any fake prophet steal your body, or if any 419 person steal your money. You are a bastard son of Wami. It means you have not learned anything. You are not learning anything from this altar. Now, how can I give to the men of God? I want to change your mentality today. Otherwise, you will always be a victim of the business pastor, business prophet. One, this will guide you not to fall again to any dubious prophet, fake prophet, and pastors looking only for your money and not your salvation. One, listen to this. Whatever you give to any man of God, they are talking of your appreciation. They are men of God, they are not God. If you are to be worshiping men of God, you have left God behind. And so many men of God also have made themselves now to be God. Because so many men of God have now believed that you cannot see God unless you see them. Whereas Jesus has said that it is finished. Now, this is how you are being robbed. And don't be robbed anymore. Anything you give men of God or prophet of God must be in appreciation to what the Lord has done for you. Not what the Lord will do for you. Am I making myself clear to you? Anything you want to give men of God from today must be in appreciation of what God has done for you. Not what God will do for you. Now, this is it. Any giving to God must be what you want God to do for you. Any giving to God must be towards what God will do for you. You can connect yourself to what you want God to do for you by giving to God. That was the giving of Jephthah. That was the giving of Anna. That was the giving of Abraham to what God will do for you. Not what the... Not give it to the prophet for what God will do for you. You hear me? No prophet can give you anything that the Lord has not given you. So stop worshiping men. Because this will liberate you from your spiritual dogmatic life. So many Christians are living in the dogmatic Christian life. Because nobody can tell them the truth. Now I'm telling you the truth. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, don't fall again. I'm making myself clear to you. Anything you want to give to the Lord must be to what you want God to do for you. Not give it to men or prophet because you want God to do this for you. No. We are missing it. I have missed it so many times also. But when I come back to learn, I now begin to find the truth. Don't give to men because you want God to give to you. Hello? Give to God what you want Him to give to you. And hear me. Your giving to God must be before your miracle. Your giving to God must be before your miracle, which is a seed of your faith. But this day, pastors make themselves to be the God, and they want you to release your faith on God via them. No! Don't go to any prophet and say, Pastor, Daddy, this is my prophetic seed. I want God to give me a baby. It's a lie. He can't give you a baby because he himself has no baby. He can't give you a car because he himself has no car. I would rather wish all of you to say, Father, prophet, this is my seed offering to the church for what I want God to do for me. Simple. Father, this is my seed for Soweto charity program because I want God to bless me with twins. Simple. Hello. Don't go to your father in the Lord anymore. Don't come to me. Father, I want to have a job. This is my 1,000 seed. If I take it and you didn't have a job, 1 month, 2 months, what do you say? You say it's a fake pastor. And you are the one that corrupted me. You are the one that corrupted me. And now, if I can't resist that 1,000 you brought to me, I chop it. I rather wish where you are seated, write that 1,000 rand and say, Lord, this is my seed for my twins. And watch what you're called. It is that seed that determines your fate. That's why Jephthah said, Lord, if you give me. That's why Anna said, Lord, if you give me. Go back to the scripture. You will find every one of them. They made a vow to God, not to man. But this day is the opposite now. Because men of God have not turned themselves to be the God of men. Now, so give it to your prophet. Must be after what the Lord has given you. Do I make myself clear? Hello? Do I make myself clear? After the Lord has given you 2 cars, you can now go and give your prophet 1. Not when you had only 1 car and your prophet had 2 or 3 cars. You now dogmatically take your own only 1 car and say, prophet, daddy, please take this car. I want God to bless me with 1 car. You are a fool. After that, prophet will use that car. I'm joining with his convoy. And then you will be trekking. You are a fool. Say, I'm more a fool. Say to your neighbor, say, neighbor, may I'm deliver. I'm no more a fool. Hello? Am I making sense to you? I mean, don't take what God has not given you. Okay, and I'm going there. Now, how to give? How can I give? I'm sure so many people that we had this message, they will not like it. They say, what this guy is talking is rubbish. Who taught him all this? But we all know the truth. How do I give? Number one, never be compelled or be forced or being coerced to give. Don't ever be forced to give. To give to God or to give to men. Don't be forced. If you are forced, it's no longer giving. It's like you are being cajoled. You are being brainwashed. You must determine whatever you want to give God or whatever you want to give man from your heart. Not when you are being forced. Do you hear what I'm saying? Never be what? Never be forced. Listen to me. Any day, anytime, any prophet or any pastor climb this altar and say to us or say to you, even if I'm not around or my mother is not around or anyone of us, and say, God said to me that there are 5 or 10 people here that must give the seed of 1,000 for the next level. Anyone, every one of you must stand up and say, excuse me, sir. Our father said we must not give like that anymore. Tell him, tell her. Are you getting what I'm saying? Because you are being forced. You are being compelled. But hear me. How can I give? It's different from when your pastor, your leader, or your church He's having a project, and the project needs others because it's for your own benefit. It's an avenue for you to be connected. Please, you don't need to be coerced to give. Rise up anything you can give. The moment the project is announced in your church that we want to build another church, or we want to buy a car for evangelism. If they say we want to do, please, I'm going there. Don't give dogmatically. Ask question. Excuse me, sir. That project you said we want to build, what is it for? Is it for our church or for other people there? Don't give dogmatically. Give with your senses now. So, how to give? Never be forced. Never be compelled. Number two, sow your seed into a fertile land. Always sow your seed. Giving is in sowing. But sow your seed. We are in a fertile land. I mean, it's a fool of you to go to any church or any program and then they are calling for sacrificial offering. Hey, brother, so. That one in white, in blue, God tell me to tell you that you must bring 50,000 rand so that God can live. And then, what you cannot give in Wami, you are giving it in Tami. You are a fool. You are a bastard. It's because I didn't teach you. Now I'm teaching you. If before you go and give in Jesus, I do it immediately. Do it in Wami, I do it also. Because at the end of the day, you go to any nonsense program everywhere, they cajole you, they take everything from you, you go back home, you are crying. Then you will now come to me on Sunday and say, Father, I am broke. You are a bastard. Why would you not broke? Because you have gone to drop something carelessly there without thinking. Sow your seed in a fertile land. Don't give carelessly. Don't be sentimental in giving. Ask yourself a question. Even if you cannot ask the pastor or the church before giving and after giving. Excuse me. If we had called for you in this ministry, how many things have we called for you in this ministry that you have not seen done? People of the Lord, it's time for us to buy the Wami wings. The bus is there. Don't we have the bus there? We have never in this ministry called for project and we collected the money. We didn't do it. Any church or anywhere you are going doing and you are giving and you are not seeing what you are giving for, you must know that you are giving to the pastor's pocket. And that's why he's buying a helicopter and aircraft. And you are not even riding on the bicycle. Hello? Give now with your what? With your senses. Ask question! When you are giving and after you are giving. Because it will enhance you to be able to give more. Or it will speak to your brain that you are what? You are a dummy. You are just an ATM. In the name of brainwashing you. Hello? Am I encouraging you not to give? I'm teaching you how to give correctly and how to start giving wisely. Hello? Give. I don't want to read scripture. Matthew chapter 13, verse 3 to 9. Teach us that we must sow our seed in a fertile land. Don't sow your seed in any conferences, in any seminar that you don't even know. You are not even going there again to reap your harvest there. That's why we don't go anywhere, just anywhere. No, we don't. Number three, how to give. Give willingly. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 9. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give. That's what the scripture says. Each of you should give what you have decided. That's why I said don't give carelessly. That's why I said don't give stupidly. That's why don't give by company. If you are going to a program or to a ministry, determine this is what I'm going to give as an offering. So that when you get there, the pastor will not cajole you. Bring 70 pounds now for 70 for seven star blessing. Bring 70 rand for 7 blessings. How many 7 of you will give 7,000 rand now for 7 blessings? Okay, today is this is the 9 months. How many of you want 9 blessings? Bring 9,000 rand now, 9 blessings. And 9 people will come. After 9 people, 90 people will come. And you see that you can ask yourself a question. Hey, but the pastor said he's looking for 9 people. Now it's 90 people. Why didn't they return the other 9? Other? Because you are what? You give carelessly. You are mumu giver. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, don't be a mumu giver anymore. Give willingly. This is Bible. Is it not Bible? The Bible didn't say be compared by the prophet. He said, give, let every one of you give what you have decided in your heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion. Under what? But you sorrow to repentance. For you, this verse says it clearly. Don't give under what? 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. New International Version. Let my children saw it. Let me see it. Each man, let's read it together. I want to go. In his heart to give. Not or under compulsion. For God love a cheerful giver. That settles the matter. Any other thing than this is unscriptural. It's mandatory. It's what? It's the bishop doctrine. It's the apostle. It's the doctrine. Anywhere, any 50 rand around you now, anywhere, anything you can lay your hands upon now, bring it to my hand, so that the Lord, you are a fool. God said, give according to what you have prepared in your heart. Listen, it's different from when the Holy Spirit now tells you, my son, be a blessing to that church. Me and my wife, we went to one country, we went to nations there, and we saw the church where we are worshiping or doing something, all manners of peace. I said, as the Lord liveth, before the end of this year, we must paint that church. They didn't ask us, they didn't compel us. The Holy Spirit told us. So Holy Spirit can tell you wherever you are in that place. Not the prophet spirit. He said, now dip your hands in your pocket and give the Lord your best, even your last money for your transport. You are a fool. That does not make you a Christian. That does not make you a giver. You are a fool. Because at the end of the day, can I tell you the truth? When you give your transport money, that man meets you at the robot. He has nobody in his car. He won't give you a lift. Because you are a momo. And you think, hey, it's my faith. It's not your faith. It's your faith. It's your stupidity. He cajole you. Is it not what God says? Number four, or whatever. Let your giving be motivated by love for God and not by force. Say it. Tell your neighbor. Let your giving be motivated by love and not by force. If you are ever forced again to give, you are a mumu. You see the kind of giving I'm teaching you now, you will never get it anywhere. Because they were after your giving to them. You will never find it anywhere. Can I tell you the truth of men of God? I don't need your giving until when God bless you. I need your giving when God bless you. After God bless you. A good teacher, a good father will tell you that. I just gave you now your school fees. And one stupid man, under the name of a prophet, whatever name, title, cajole you on Monday. He said, everything that is in your pocket now, bring it for the Lord to give you, for you to pass your exam. And then you just take everything also. Widow's mind. Widow's mind. Hello. Nyamba. Now, I want you to also know that let giving be your lifestyle. Giving must be your lifestyle, but you must give wisely. Number four or five, whatever it is, let your giving cost you something, or let your giving move God. Anytime you are giving, either to men or to God, according to the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, give something tangible. Hello? Don't you want to give a man something? Don't always give the shoe that you cannot even wear anymore. And then say, on the name of giving, say you are giving. Okay, fine. If that's what you have, thank God for it. But sometimes ago, or some another time, try something also that from that beautiful set. Who said that brother does not need a beautiful set? Give him or give her something beautiful also. Hello? Let giving be your lifestyle. Don't give this man and don't give another man. No, keep giving in whatever capacity the Lord enables you. People of God, don't borrow to give. That's where I'm going now. Don't give what God has not given you. Do you know what I say? Don't give what God has not given you. God is not wicked. He won't give what he has not given you. He asked for Isaac because he gave Isaac before. Hello. Don't. No more stupidity. Number five. What to give or how to give. Give continuously. Give thanksgiving to God. Give daily, give weekly, give monthly, give yearly, give seasonally. Let this be your life. Giving be your lifestyle. And how can it be your lifestyle? Give daily, give weekly, give. And what am I giving? Give thanksgiving continuously. Thanksgiving continuously. Every day, whether it is right, whether it is good, give thanksgiving. See what the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 66, verse 23. He said, all humanity will come to worship me from week to week, from month to month, from one moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, all mankind. Isaiah chapter 66, verse 23, studio. Give every day, every time. Every Sunday, every Wednesday, every week, every month, every year. Live a life of giving. Let giving be your lifestyle. That's where offering and tithe comes in. Hello, people of God. Did I center now on offering and tithe? It's just one of the ways of giving continually. Your Sunday offering, your monthly tithe, your weekly tithe, they are part of the giving, not the only giving that the word or the doctrine has made us to know. And lastly, continuous testimony to God. Father, I thank you. Give continuous testimony to the Lord, not to men, to God. Unfortunately, this day, hear me. Prophet has idolatry themselves, thinking that they are the one doing whatever God has done in the life of people. So you see, if I had prayed for you, don't give testimony to me. So if you come to this altar, people of the Lord, I want to thank God for what the Lord has done for me. It's your first thing you must say. I went to Papa, or I went to past brother, and he prayed with me, and the Lord. If God has not given you, I can't give whatever God has not given. I'm only building your faith. And of course, in the prophetic agenda of God, God honored the word of prophets. So when you come to me, your faith is not high to my level. So when I speak to the Lord, God build that testimony because I have said it as a prophet. That does not make me to be the doer of your testimony. But instead, that's why pastors have made people to now idolate them. Hey, my papa has given me, has prayed for me last week. Therefore, now I must worship him. Where are you now worshiping God instead of worshiping your papa? The papa will also be doing like this. It's me. It's me. It's me. They've made themselves gods over the people. Hello? Let your testimony be God's adoration and not man adoration. He said, I will bless the Lord all times. His praises are continually be in my mouth. I will bless the Lord all times. Psalm 34 verse 1. Blessing the Lord all time is part of your giving life. Finally, never give what God has never given you. And before that, be expectant from God anytime you are giving. Be what? Expectant. Because it is the level of your giving to God that will determine your level of expectation from Him. Be expectant from God. Give to men, don't expect men to give back to you. But give to God, expect God to give back to you. My God will give you whatever is your heart desire. This morning is a secret of living. Be a giver. Live a giving life. But let your living or your giving be a productive giving. A what? A productive giving. I've given you so many secrets. Please take the one that belongs to you. And virtually everything belongs to you. Give your time. Give your heart. Give to the poor. Give to the men of God. But before God, give to men. Don't be a stupid giver. Be a continuous giver. Hallelujah. Is there anything that is still confusing you now? Ask me a question before I close. I give two people or three people to ask me a question. Then I will close the service. After that, I want you to, you will now stand up just to appreciate God in thanksgiving. Listen, part of our thanksgiving is our praises and our worship and our seed unto Him. Father, I cannot quantify what you have given me, but from my heart, I give to you thanksgiving seed. It's different from your Sunday offering. And if you don't have if only what you have on Sunday is your offering, you can also connect to it and say, God, this is my Sunday offering. And this is all that I have. Thank you. God sees your heart. Hello. God what? Sees your heart. And not only your heart, God sees your pocket. He sees your wallet. He what? He sees your wallet. Hello. If you are here, you can buy something. You can buy a gift of 1,000 or 10,000 for your wife, for your brother, for your child, and it's difficult for you. That's why the issue of tithing comes in now. It's difficult for you to give God something. Okay, what is it can I give? God say, even if you don't want to give me 10,000, at least give me 10% of what to give your wife or your wife or your child. So at least you have a measure for you not to, okay, Jay, I don't know, but okay, now God has given you a measure. You are a stingy person if you can't do that. God knows your wallet. God knows your capacity. God knows how much you are keeping in your account and how much you are giving him. And you say you are living a life of thanksgiving. No. Give quantitatively. Give what will move God to do more than what you have. Every type of giving, they are relevant to God. But give them with your wisdom, with your knowledge, with your understanding. Any question? Take the microphone. Any question?